Okay, so how you are having, you know, Struts, Spring, Hibernate in your Java, all these are what, you know, collection is what, it's a framework, right? It's a framework. So how you are having all these frameworks in your Java, this Hadoop is also what, a framework. This Hadoop is also a framework. This is actually an open source framework which has been overseen by Apache Software Foundation. So if somebody is just trying to make some software as open source, it is none other than, you know, Apache Software Foundation only. You might have listened that. Okay, so Apache Software Foundation only it is. So basically this Hadoop has been given by that Cloudera University people, but later this Apache Software Foundation has just made this Hadoop as what, open source. So you need not to pay anything, you can directly download that and you can directly install that and you can use that one. So industries will always prefer working with what, open source softwares, but not with commercial softwares because they can invest much. So always prefer working with what, open source softwares. Because of that only this Hadoop also has been made as an open source by that Apache Software Foundation. So then why we are having this Hadoop? Hadoop is there basically for storing and for processing huge data sets, but not recommended for working with what, small data sets. I told you already, what is the use of distributing small work to 10 guys? It will take more time, right? Suppose if I wanted to do if I wanted to read 10 GB of data by keeping that in my local machine, how much time it is taking? Just say that 20 minutes it is taking. If I wanted to distribute that 10 GB of data to what, 10 systems, and if I wanted to let them to process parallelly, and if I wanted to combine that output, if I wanted to get that final output, how much time it is taking? Sometimes it may be taking 40 minutes also because of distributing and before of, because of, you know, combining that output. So instead of doing that, better you can start working small data sets in your local machine itself without distributing your task. Right or wrong? So for small data sets, you need not to go for Hadoop and you need not to invest much by keeping number of machines in your cluster. Better you can, you know, better you can go for that local file system itself if your data set is small. And when we are going for this Hadoop, you know, Hadoop is an open source framework overseen by Apache Software Foundation for storing and for processing huge data sets with a cluster of commodity hardwares. What is a cluster? What is a commodity hardware? That everything we are going to discuss now. Okay, that terminology is very, very important in this Hadoop. What is commodity hardware? You know, what is cluster? All those things are very, very important. You know very well about cluster, right? What is a cluster? You know, set of machines in a, you know, single LAN. Okay, so that is actually what cluster. What is a commodity hardware? What is a commodity hardware? What is that commodity hardware? You know, cheap hardware. Generally, you know, something like your PCs or your laptops, which we are using in our homes. Sir, you are saying that, what is this, sir? We have paid, you know, 40,000 rupees or 45,000 rupees, but you are saying that we are using cheap hardware. You know, absolutely, we are maintaining what, cheap hardware only in our laptops and in our PCs. Those are all not high reliable hardware. So because of that only, for every 6 months or for every 3 months, you are, you know, getting that laptop to service center. But if you are maintaining high reliable hardware, if you wanted to maintain high reliable hardware, if you wanted to purchase 1 TB of hard disk, you have to invest minimum 10 lakh rupees. But for that, you know, that same 1 TB of hard disk, you are getting for what? 40,000 rupees, even for 28,000 rupees also now. Right, that depends on your configuration, that of your laptop. Right, so, but if you are on, if you wanted to maintain high reliable hardware where you are not, where you are not supposed to get any more failover, you have to invest more than 10 lakh rupees for that 1 TB of hard disk. Right, so exactly, this Hadoop need not to work with what, high reliable hardware. This Hadoop is enough for working with what, cheap hardwares. Suppose, how does it seems like, if I wanted to maintain 500 terabytes of data, if I wanted to use high reliable hardware like servers, I have to invest more than 4 to 5 crore rupees. Just say that. Just say that. If I wanted to store this same 500 TB of data with normal laptops or PCs, it is enough to invest what? 1 to 1.25 crore rupees. So, isn't it there? I mean, huge difference is there or not? Right or wrong? So, companies will not always, you know, see at getting more profits, they are even see at what, you know, investments also. They have to invest less and they have to get more profits. So as this Hadoop is there, as it can support what commodity hardware, we need not to go for what high reliable hardware by investing much. You can go for what, you know, cheap hardware. You may be getting some doubt, sir, as you are saying that we are using cheap hardware, there may be, you know, failures on our system. If system is going to be down, are we going to lose the data or not? Yes. So even though you are going to lose the data also, this Hadoop can overcome all those problems. How it can be done, that we will see one by one now. So exactly, how can we store data? What that Yahoo has given? How you are going to store your data? You know, you are using HDFS. Hadoop Distributed File System. How you are processing your data? MapReduce. So basically, this Hadoop is there for storing and for processing huge data sets. Storing and for processing means what? Can we say that it is a combination of HDFS and MapReduce? This Hadoop is a combination of what? HDFS and MapReduce, because it can store that data with HDFS and it can process that data with what? MapReduce. So here we are having two core concepts. One is HDFS, another one is what? MapReduce. Okay, just keep that. Hadoop is having two core concepts. One is, are two core concepts, are two core components. You can take like something like anything. Okay, next, observe here. So what those two are? HDFS and what? MapReduce. So we will see this MapReduce later. Okay, this HDFS will take at least 2 to 3 classes of, you know, okay, time. But later we will see what this MapReduce in detail. Okay, just let me remove this one. Now we will start discussing what HDFS. What is this HDFS? If somebody is asking you that what is HDFS, don't let them know that Hadoop Distributed File System it is. Just let them know that, you know, Hadoop is there for storing and for processing your data. So HDFS is there for what? Storing. Yes, for storing your data. So get that terminology. Okay, one by one. So Hadoop Distributed File System is a specially designed file system for storing huge data sets with cluster of commodity hardwares with streaming access pattern. With a streaming access pattern. So you know very well about cluster, you know very well about commodity hardware, and we have to know about what, you know, streaming access pattern. What is streaming access pattern? What is streaming access pattern? It is a specially designed file system. File system means for storing huge data sets with cluster of commodity hardware and with streaming access pattern. Streaming access pattern. So you know very well about what cluster, commodity hardware, and what is that streaming access pattern is exactly. You know, one slogan is there in Java, right? Very good, super. Okay, write once, run anywhere. Run anywhere means what? Running in India, running in US, not something like that. Running on any platform, any OS. Okay, either Unix or Linux or whatever it may be, either Windows or whatever it may be, okay? Any, yes, platform independent. So how you are having that slogan in Java, here also this Hadoop is having one slogan. Write once, read any number of times, but don't try to change that content of the file once you are keeping that data into HDFS. Write once, read any number of times, but don't change that content of the file. That is what streaming access pattern is. That is what streaming access pattern is, exactly. Okay, clear up to this? Fine, sir. Then what is this file system? Why you are saying, you know, it is specially designed? Why you are saying that it is specially designed? Let's see. File system means storing files and directories, right or wrong? It's a way of what? Storing your files and directories. Generally, where we are going to store our files and directories? In hard disk. So can we say that hard disk is a file system? But when it, you know, when it is getting some capability of storing your files and directories, when you are going to boot your OS, right or wrong? When you are giving that OS, then only your hard disk will get some capability about storing your files and directories, okay, with that file system support. Fine. Sir, how it is going to store that? You might have seen sectors, hard disk, internal structure. You know that? Let me show you this. Suppose if this hard disk is 500 GB of hard disk. 500 GB of hard disk capacity is set. So we can call this as a block. These are all what? Sectors. You know, lines are called as what? Sectors. You might have seen in Unix or something that. Okay. You know, this will be called as what? One block. What is its block size? What is its block size? 4 KB. 4 KB. So how many 4 KBs we need to have for this 500 GB of hard disk? You need to have plenty of 4 KB, you know, blocks. Right or wrong? Getting what I'm telling you? Okay, concentrate here. Very, very simple. If you can understand this, it would be very easy. What is this HDFS? Understanding that. Okay. So how you are having this is what? One 4 KB of block. Suppose in this 4 KB of block, I'm storing one small file and its size is 2 KB only. 2 KB will be stored in this 4 KB of block. And what about that remaining 2 KB of empty space? Is it going to be wasted or is it going to be used for some other file? Never. It will be wasted. That remaining 2 KB of memory, I mean that free space will be wasted. Now see, this is actually what hard disk and normal file system. If you are going to boot your OS, these blocks will be, you know, given for Unix or Linux based operating systems. Now see, so we are going to design what HDFS now. On top of this OS, on top of this hard disk, we are going to, you know, install Hadoop with some HDFS. Because of this HDFS has been by default given with what? With some block size. What is that block size? 64 MB. 64 MB block size will be there for this HDFS. That's what we are saying it is. It is a specially designed file system. You know, getting what I'm telling you? So on top of this normal hard disk, you know, on top of this normal OS of on that hard disk, this HDFS has been designed by giving what? Hadoop installation. So because of giving this HDFS, now it will become what? 164 MB of block size. HDFS can give 64 MB of block size, what default block size. Or you can make it as what? 128 MB also. But by default it is what? 64 MB of block size. Okay. What is that HDFS block size? 64 MB. So how many 4 KBs we need to have for 64 MB? Plenty. We need to have plenty, right? So I'm just trying to combine plenty of 4 KB of blocks and I'm making it as what? 164 MB of block size. Now observe here. After installing this HDFS, after installing this Hadoop and setting up this HDFS, now I'm storing some file and my file size is 35 MB. 35 MB. This 35 MB will be taken into 164 MB block. So are we going to have some remaining, free space or not? Right or wrong? How much space will be there? How much space will be there? 29 MB space will be there. Is that space will be, you know, released for some other file or is it going to be wasted? Yes, absolutely fine. On normal hard disk, on normal OS, your block will not be released for some other, you know, file. But here, it is releasing that memory for what? Some other file. Because, sir, why you are taking this block size is what, you know, 64 MB of block size. Huge difference is there, right? In between that 4 KB and what? 64 MB. 1 MB means 1024 KB. Something like that you are taking what? 1024 into 64 KB of, you know, size you are taking. So why should we go for that much capacity of block size here? Because your Hadoop is storing huge data sets, but not small data sets. If you wanted to store that much of huge amount of data in small data sets, it is taking what? You know, more metadata. I'll tell you what is that metadata and all those things. So instead of doing that, as this Hadoop is supporting for storing huge data sets, for processing huge data sets, they have just taken this block size as what? Big block size as 64 MB of block size or what? 128 MB also you can take it as. Clear up to this? Nothing is there here. On top of this hard disk, you have given what? HDFS. Because of that only it is taking what? 64 MB of block size. If suppose I'm just trying to, you know, uninstall that Hadoop. So automatically that remaining, that time that 64 MB will not be there, 4 KB of blocks only will be there. There is no problem at all. Getting what I'm telling you? So this is that. So on 4 KB of block size, that remaining space will be wasted but on 64 MB of block size, when we are installing this Hadoop, that remaining space will not be, you know, wasted. It will be used for some other file. Because if we are go on wasting that much of space, you have to maintain more number of systems. Right or wrong? If suppose if I am going to store 1 KB of data out of this 64 MB, but what about that remaining space? If it is go on wasting, you need to have more number of systems. Right or wrong? Because it is not at a small block size, right? Big block size. So for 500 GB of data, how many number of 64 MB blocks will be there? What is that? Come on, just calculate that. For 1 GB, how many number of 64 MB blocks will be there? Just make it as 15. 15 into 60, 900. 900 into 4, 60. Something like what? 16 or 17 it is giving. Sorry, 15 or 16 it is giving. Right or wrong? For 1 GB it is giving 15 64 MB blocks. For 500 GB, 5 into 15, 75,000. Or 75,000 or 7,500. 7,500. 7,500. Okay, 7,500 blocks will be given for that. Clear? Up to this. Now you got some idea that why it has been designed specially? Because your Hadoop is storing huge data sets, but it is not recommended for what? Small data sets. Because of that, only this HDFS block size has become as what? You know, 64 MB of block size, or you can make it as what? 128 MB also. Metal, but by default it is what? 64 MB. If you are feeling that, sir, I am maintaining very much huge data sets, that time you can go for what? Even 128 MB also, by changing those configurations. Generally, who should take care of this, you know, giving this HDFS, all those things? Hadoop administrator should take care of that. We are purely developers. We are not administrators. We are purely developers. So an administrator should take care of this HDFS, but not ourselves. Clear up to this? Okay, so half of part you have understood right now. Now let's start discussing why this, you know, how this Hadoop is going to, I mean, how this HDFS is going to store your data. Sorry, as you are saying that Yahoo has modified that GFS and it has released what? HDFS, as it is having some problems in that. So what are all the advantages we are having in this HDFS now? That we will see with some small architecture. Okay, observe here. So what is your default block size? 64 MB. Don't note down anything here onwards. I'll give you time. Please just stare on the board. That's it. Don't do anything. Very, very important. If you can understand this, nothing is there in this Hadoop. Let me come to this discussion. Observe here. This HDFS is having five services. What are all those? First one, you might have listened, name node. Second one, secondary name node. Third one, what is that? Job tracker. Fourth one, data node. Last one, task tracker. Very, very easy and very, very important. Just see this one. This HDFS is having five services: name node, secondary name node, job tracker, data node, and task tracker. Top three are master services. You can call them like what? Master services, or you can call them like as what? You know, master daemons or master nodes. Anything you can call them as like. Next, bottom two are what? Yes, slave services are what? Slave nodes or slave daemons. Daemon means, you know, it's a background process. You cannot have physical appearance on that, but in background it is just trying to run that one. So that is what daemon. So these are all services are what? We cannot see them physically, but these are all what running internally. That's what we are calling them as daemons. Top three are master services, bottom two are what? Slave services. Every master service can talk to each other. Every master service can talk to each other. Every slave service also can talk to each other. If name node is a master node, its corresponding slave node is what? Data node. If job tracker is a master node, its corresponding slave node is what? Task tracker. So name node can talk to data node, vice versa. And job tracker can talk to task tracker, vice versa. But name node cannot talk to task tracker, job tracker cannot talk to data node. But these three can talk to each other, these two can talk to each other. Clear? Top 3 are master services, bottom 2 are slave services. Every master service can talk to each other, every slave service also can talk to each other. You know, if name node is a master node, that data node is what? Its corresponding slave node, so that they can talk to each other. And if that job tracker is a master service, its corresponding slave service is what? Task tracker, so that they can talk to each other. Done, right? Okay, let me come to this discussion now. Suppose one client is there. Client is having one mission. Now he wanted to store and he wanted to process some data. What he is thinking is, he is, even though he is having proper storage capacity also, if he wanted to process that data, it is taking more time. For that sense, as he wanted to complete that job in what less time, he wanted to put that into Hadoop. No, he wanted to maintain one cluster with more number of machines and he wanted to share that data to what number of machines. So that work will be done in what less time, right? Because that is the what intention of what Hadoop, right or wrong? Right? So just say that this file, this client is having one file, its size is 200 MB. Sir, 200 MB, what is this, sir? 200 MB is what, somewhat, you know, small data set, right? Why should we go for Hadoop? For your easy understanding purpose only, I have given what this 200 MB of data. Just think that this is what 500 TB of data. Okay, for your easy understanding purpose only, I am giving what 200 MB of data. Fine. So his file name is file.txt. And its size is 200 MB. As this client is thinking that as there is no proper storage capacity, as there is no proper processing power, he wanted to split this data into what number of machines, and he wanted to arrange some Hadoop, and he wanted to process that in what less time. Clear? Okay, fine. Now client wanted to put this 200 MB of file into this cluster so that his work will be done bit fast. If you wanted to put this 200 MB of file into this cluster is with what? Hadoop, right? So Hadoop will be built on top of normal file system. So its block size become what? 64 MB, right or wrong? So this 200 MB of file is going to be split into what? Number of 64 MB blocks, right? So how many blocks it is going to give you exactly? You should not lost 0.00001 KB of data. So you should give what exactly 200 MB of data into that cluster. How many blocks will be given? If that HDFS block size is what 64 MB of block size, how many number of 64 MB of block sizes we are going to get for this 200 MB of file? 4. 3 into 64, 192 and what? 18 MB extra. Right? So basically, this client need not to worry of what splitting that 200 MB of file into number of input splits. He can directly put this 200 MB of file into that cluster so that that name node itself can take care of that, how to split that 200 MB of file into number of 64 MB blocks. That this client basically need not to worry of that. But for your easy understanding purpose, here I am going to give you 4 input splits file names. For your easy understanding purpose, okay? So just say that 3 64 MB blocks and what? 18 MB block size, right? So a.txt file it is giving, b.txt file, c.txt file, and finally d.txt file is there. Its size is 64 MB and what? 8 MB. Even though it is 8 MB, where this 8 MB will be stored? In 64 MB of block size. But that remaining, you know, how much data will be remained? 56. That 56 MB of space will be, you know, will be given for some other file, but it will not be wasted. Okay, fine. Now if this client wanted to put this 200 MB of file into this cluster, to whom this client should contact with? Does this client know what are all the data nodes which are having free space to store his data? He doesn't know because he is outside to that cluster. So generally, to whom this client should contact with? Okay, name node. Fine. Let me give you one small example so that you will be getting broad idea about this cluster, you know. See this one. As we have discussed, one farmer is there. That farmer is having one small field. Okay. Now he is having one small home. Initially, he has generated 10 rice packets. He is going to store them in his home in some corner of the room. Next year, he has generated 20. Anyhow, he is making that room somewhat bigger and he is going to store them. Next to that year, he has generated 50 and he is going to, you know, arrange all those 50 rice packets in half of his home. By the next year, he has generated 200 rice packets as he is having good climate facility and good water facility. Now, if he wanted to store these 200 rice packets in his home, is it possible? Definitely, it is not possible. So what is that alternative solution? We should not throw them out as you are not having proper storage capacity, right or wrong? So we must store them in some other location. What is that? Generally, these guys will approach a godam, a big godam, right? So he is approaching a big godam. So by taking all his rice packets, you know, through some lorry. Just say that. Okay, through some lorry. Observe here. Once he is approaching this godam, does this client, does this farmer knows what are all the rooms which are having free space to store his rice packets? He is not aware of that. Then to whom this farmer should contact with? Yes, manager. Some manager will be there for that godam. So he has to, you know, approach that manager. He will be there in some chamber. And he knows very well that as he is maintaining that godam, he knows very well that what are all the rooms which are having free space. Now this client is approaching that manager and he is asking that, hey manager, as I am not having proper storage capacity in my home, I have brought 200 rice packets to your godam. I am not aware of that what are all the rooms which are having free space. I just wanted to store them in your, you know, rooms. Please give me those details so that I can go and store these rice packets. And immediately he is asking that, how many rice packets you have brought and what are all the quality of rice packets? Just say that this farmer is giving, I have brought 30 rupees quality rice packets, kg 30 rupees, kg 40 rupees quality rice packet and 50 rupees quality rice packets. I have brought 50 rice packets, 30 rupees quality rice packet and 50 for 40 and 100 of what? 50 rupees quality rice packet. Okay, now this farmer is just trying to, this manager is just trying to take his details. Right or wrong? Generally when you are approaching some good, that guy will take all details of this farmer, you know. Now he is taking some white paper and he is trying to fill up that form. What is that farmer's name? Just say that Ram. And how many packets he has brought? 200 rice packets. Fine. Now what are all the quality of rice packets? 30 rupees quality rice packets are there, 50, 40 rupees also there, 50 and 50 rupees quality rice packets also there for 100. Now he is taking all those details in this white paper. Why he is taking that? If some other day, if this client is going to complete all his rice packets in his home, he has to approach that godam. Again, he has to fetch them back to his home to feed his family, right or wrong? By the time he is approaching that godam, if he is not having that paper, what will happen? There will be big fight in between that manager and that farmer. Right or wrong? Right? So generally, who is going to win? Farmer only will obviously win that. Right or wrong? So now this farmer, this manager is just saying that, hey farmer, please go and store your rice packets in room number 1, 3 or something, you know, sometimes. Even though this manager is also not aware of that, he is having some PA, right? That PA will take care of all those things. Now that PA will be given with some work. That PA is just trying to take care of what? Storing all his rice packets. Now he is going to store 30 rupees quality rice packets in room number 1, 40 rupees quality rice packets in room number 3, you know, 40 rupees quality rice packets in room number 3 and 50 rupees quality rice packets in room number 7. He is storing all these rice packets and that PA is saying that, sir, I have stored, I have let some other people have, you know, to store 30 rupees quality rice packets in room number 1, 3 in, you know, in room number 3 40 rupees, in room number 7 50 rupees. So that he is taking about what? Room number 1, 3 and what? 7. Right? In that paper. So this is what? Small example. Now observe here, what we are calling it is details about storing your rice packets. So details about your rice packets, details about your data. Just say that data about data. What is data about data? Metadata. Now client wanted to put this 200 MB of data into this cluster. Does this client know what are all the data nodes which are having free space to store his? Now to whom this client should contact with? Name node seems like a manager. How you are having manager in your godam? Now this client is sending some request to this name node and he is saying that, hey name node, as I cannot store, as I cannot process this data in less time, I just wanted to put this data into your cluster. I am not aware of that what are all the data nodes which are having free space to store this 200 MB of data. Just give me those data so that I can store all this, you know, 200 MB of file into your data nodes. Something like this, it is sending some request to name node. Now once that name node is receiving that request, now this name node is just trying to take care of that metadata. So what it is taking? You know, it is trying to take what? Metadata. Right or wrong? How your manager has taken that metadata, here also that name node should take care of that, taking all your details. Now it is starting taking that. So what is your file name? What is your file name? File.txt. What is its size? 200 MB. So how many blocks are there? four input splits. I mean, input splits, these are all. Four input splits are there. So what are all those? A.txt, B.txt, C.txt, and what? D.txt file. D.txt file. Fine. So as it is storing all those details in its metadata, now this name node is, you know, giving some proper response back to this client, and it is saying that, hey client, please go and store your rise, I mean your 200 MB of file in room number, you know, in data node 1, 2, sorry, data node 3, 5 and 7. It is saying that please go and store your 200 MB of file into different data nodes. 1, 3, 5 and 7, these are having what? Free space. Something like this, it is giving some response. Now this client knows very well that what are all the data nodes which are having free space. Now this client is directly approaching these systems. Okay, just say that system number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Now this client is approaching system number 1 and it is keeping a.txt file. And it is keeping a.txt file. See, all your files need not to be in some sequence order, how they have, you know, how you are getting some system numbers from your name node. It can be of, you know, randomly also. Clear? Now this client is putting this a.txt file into data node 1. Once it is going to be done, so as we have discussed, as all these data nodes are what, you know, commodity hardwares, cheap hardwares, right or wrong? All these are what? Cheap hardwares. Every data node will be there with some 250 GB of, you know, hard disk capacity or 500 GB of hard disk capacity. If it is 500 GB of hard disk capacity, how many number of blocks will be there? 7500. If it is 250 GB of, you know, hard disk capacity, then how many number of blocks will be there? 3750. Right, so those many number of blocks will be there. Out of all those blocks, it is just trying to keep this a.txt file in 164 MB of block. If suppose, as we are maintaining cheap hardware, what will happen if this system is going to be down? Are we going to lose that a.txt file or not? Sir, again it seems like what, same problem how we are facing in what, traditional distributed file systems. So how to overcome this problem here? For to overcome that problem, this HDFS has been given by default, you know, by giving three replications by default. This HDFS has been introduced by giving three replications by default. So keep two more backup files for your a.txt file, for any file it may be. Now what it will become if you wanted to store 200 MB of data? Now what it becomes, how much size it is occupying? 600 MB of size, right or wrong? It is giving what? Three replications. Replication means what? An extra copy, backup or redundant file, whatever you can think it as. Okay, backup file. So sir, where we are going to specify all those, you know, replications, that we will see in next class. Okay, we are going to discuss that with some, you know, three XML files. Those are the heart of this Hadoop. Clear? That we will discuss later. Now as this Hadoop has been, as this HDFS has been given with three replications by default. Now this client has given a.txt file here. This data node knows very well that the same a.txt file should be copied into some other data node, as it is, you know, supporting with what, three replications by default. Now it is keeping the same a.txt file to some other system. Just say that system number 2 is also having some free space. Now it is keeping a.txt file here in this. Why we are taking replications? To overcome that data loss problem. Now this data node internally gives this same a.txt file to some other system where you are having same free space, you know, and it is keeping that a.txt file here. Once it is done, now does this client need to know this one or not, whether this a.txt file has been exactly stored without any data loss problem or not? Right or wrong? For that reason, this data node will give proper acknowledgement back to this data node, and it is saying that, hey data node 2, that file which I have sent has been exactly stored in my local data node. Something in the same way, you know, this data node also will give same acknowledgement back to this data node, and it is saying that, hey data node 1, the file which I have sent has been exactly stored in my local data node 2, as well as it has been exactly stored in local data node 4. Something like this, it is giving, you know, some acknowledgement back to this data node also. Now this data node will give same acknowledgement back to this client, and it is saying that, client, the file which I have sent has been exactly stored in my local data node, as well as it has been taken in what, system number 2, as well as it has been taken in system number 4 also. Even though if one file is going to be lost also, you need not to worry, we have some extra backup. Something that it is giving some acknowledgement back to this client. Okay, once it is done, how this name node can know where this ADR TXT file has been exactly stored. Right or wrong? How this, you know, 30 rupees quality rice packets have been stored in room number 1. He is taking that one here, right? So here also, this name node should take care of that, where this ADR TXT file has been, you know, stored, in which data node it is. Right? That should be taken care by that name node. For that reason, all these data nodes are what? Slave nodes for that name node, right? So all these slave nodes will give proper block report and proper, you know, heartbeat for every short period of time to that name node. For every short period of time, all these data nodes will give proper block report and heartbeat back to this name node to say that some client has stored some block in my local data node, and to say that we are still alive and we are still processing properly. You know, block report will be there to specify that name node, that this name, this data node has been allocated with some block. And heartbeat is there for specifying that this heart, I mean this data node is still alive and it is still working properly. Okay, so every data node will give proper block report as well as, you know, and heartbeat also for every short period of time. Now as all these data nodes are giving proper block report, now because of giving that block report, it is just trying to take system number 1, you know, 2 and 4. Block reports means what? If some data node is just trying to keep some block in its local data node, because of giving that block report back to that name node, okay, that name node will take care of what? Taking that, you know, system number for that block in its metadata. That will be taken care by that, you know, name node for creating that metadata. So once it is done, so in the same way, if this client is, I mean, client should keep that b.txt file also, right? c.txt file as well as d.txt file also. Right or wrong? So I need not to tell you all those things. You have understood how this a.txt file has been given with 3 replications, right? So b also will be given. So just say that b has been given in system number 3, 5 and 7 or 8. System number, you know, 5, 6 and 7. System number 7, 9 and 10. Okay? So all this should be done with some replication, right? Now how much data has been occupied for this 200 MB of file? 600 MB of data has been occupied. Right or wrong? Clear up to this? This is what storage in your HDFS. In this way, storage will be done. Getting what I'm telling you? If suppose, if any of these data nodes are not giving proper heartbeat in time, leave about, you know, giving block reports. Block reports will not be given every time. Sometimes only they are going to give, because when these clients are going to put some block into this local data node, that time only it is giving what? Block report. But for every short period of time, it should send some heartbeat to that name node to say that they are still alive and to say that they are still working properly. If suppose at any time, if some of these data nodes are not giving heartbeat, then this name node will just think it of that data node may be dead. That data node may be dead. Suppose if that same situation has come for this data node 1, just think that. Now data node 1 gets dead. So as it is dead, this data node will not send heartbeat back to this name node. As it is not receiving that heartbeat from name node, it is just thinking that, okay, system 1 may be dead, so that we have to remove that metadata from its, you know, hard disk. Once it is down, it is removing that system number 1 for this a.txt file. Now how many replications are there? Just 2. But it should be filled up with what? Third replication, right? For that reason, this name node will choose that some other data node out of all this, and it is just keeping that same a.txt file into some other system. That time, again that system also will give some proper block report and heartbeat, right? So at the time when it is giving heartbeat and block report back to this name node, it is just trying to create that metadata for this. Just say that system number 7. It is taking that. So anyhow, even though you are going to lose one data set, one data node, your data will not be lost. It will be taken care by that name node. You know, giving that name node will give that 3 replications in fraction of seconds. That you need not to worry of. So that administrator will take care of what? You know, rejoining this data node back to this cluster. When that guy is going to rejoin this data node back to this cluster, this data node will never have any more data. Freshly, it will be started with some, you know, new storage. Clear? This is actually what? Storage. Now let me come to this actual discussion. Sir, you are saying that if this paper is going to be lost, you are saying that some fight will be there in between that manager and what? You know, farmer. What will happen if that metadata is going to be lost? What will happen if that metadata will be lost? If there is no metadata, simply you can understand, even though your Hadoop is running also, there is no use with that Hadoop. there is no use with that Hadoop. If there is no metadata, there is no use with this Hadoop. Okay, your cluster is what? Entire cluster is what? Inaccessible. Your HDFS will never be working. Clear? Just understand that. Later we will see why it is, you know, not useful if you are going to lose that metadata. Observe here. So generally, this is what name node, right? These are all what cheap hardwares. But better you can maintain this name node with what high reliable hardware. Why it is, sir? Who is creating metadata? Where that metadata will be stored? In name nodes hard disk only. In name node hard disk only that metadata will be stored. So losing that metadata means what? Name node also will not be there. If name node is not there, metadata will not be there. If metadata is not there, then entire cluster is what? Inaccessible. We cannot do anything in that cluster. Fine. So to overcome that problem, better you can maintain that name node with what? High reliable hardware. Why it is, sir? So generally, where that actual data will be stored? In data nodes. See this one. For writing 200 MB of, you know, for writing 200 rice packets details, you are taking one small paper for writing those details. But for storing those rice packets, you are physically occupying, you know, room spaces. How much space you need for storing those, you know, rice packets? Physically you are going to have, you know, one room space. But for taking those details, how much, you know, memory you are taking, how much space you are taking? Just a line in that white paper. So if I wanted to store 1 lakh rice packets, do I need to have that much of storage in this, you know, paper? Need not to be, right? Because it is just trying to take what metadata. Here also, if I wanted to store 500 terabytes of data in this all data nodes, generally data nodes are being allocated with somewhat, you know, actual storage. But name node will take care of that metadata, that's it. For if you wanted to, suppose if you wanted to keep 500 terabytes of data in all these data nodes, it is enough to maintain what 512 MB of, you know, hard disk in your name node. Getting my intention? Clear? So name node is just trying to create metadata, but data nodes will give actual storage. Okay? So for keeping metadata, you need not to have that much of, you know, huge storage. You can better have what? Less storage only. Less storage only. And one more thing. Now I'll just, you know, give you one question. Sir, because of putting this Hadoop, now your hard disk, you know, block size will become what? 64 MB. Why they have just made this one as what? 64 MB. Why can't we maintain what? 4 KB. Of course, I wanted to store 500 terabytes of data. But what is, you know, what is the difference between what? Maintaining that 4 KB and 64 MB of block size. Suppose if you wanted to maintain 4 KB of block size, you need to maintain high, you know, high cable of hard disk in your name node. Because for keeping 4 KB of block, it should take care of that metadata. For keeping another 4 KB of block size, it should keep metadata for that again. So if this system is going to give 1 crore rupees of, you know, 1 crore blocks, it should take care of what? Creating metadata for those 1 crore blocks. But now, how many blocks are there for 500 GB of data? You know, 7500. For creating metadata for that 7500 blocks, how much memory it is occupying? Less. So this is what the best reason why they have made this block size is what? You know, 64 MB of block size. Okay, see, we should not get confusion because of seeing this metadata, because this entire thing will happen because of that metadata only. By seeing that metadata, we should not be confused. You know, if you are having huge block sizes, then this metadata will have what? Less, you know, data. So by seeing that, we can easily understand that, okay, these are our blocks and these get stored in what? Different data nodes. So for decreasing that, you know, storage capacity in your name node, they have just made this block size what? Huge block sizes. So that if you wanted to store 500 terabytes of data in this cluster, better you can maintain 512 MB of, you know, hard disk capacity in your name node. As you are maintaining very less hard disk capacity, you need not to go for what? Cheap hardware. Better you can maintain with what? High reliable hardware to overcome that, you know, data loss problem on your metadata. To overcome all those problems, better you can maintain that name node with what? High reliable hardware. Why it is, sir? If suppose if one data node is going to be lost, same data node is, I mean, some other data node is there where you have kept that same a.txt file. So this will be used. There is no problem. If two are going to be lost, some other will be there. But if that name node is going to be lost, do you have any other alternative way to keep that metadata? There is no such way. Right? So this one we are calling it as what? Single point of failover. Name node will be called as what? Single point of failover. If that name node is going to be lost, nothing will be possible. Nothing will be possible. Everything will be what? Inaccessible. Everything will be what? Inaccessible. For that reason, what we are saying that name node as? Single point of failover. Clear? Up to this? Okay. Okay. So this is up to what? Storage part. So if client wanted to store the data, to whom this client should contact with? Name node. So that name node only knows that where that data should be taken into different data nodes. Fine. Observe here now. I'm taking system number one only here. Now what I'm doing is, I have stored that data. I have to process that. If I wanted to process that, what I have to do? Right, exactly. So storage has been done. Now you have to come for what? MapReduce. Now see, I'll write some program. So if I wanted to process 200 MB of data, do I need to write some program or not? That program may be either Java program, any scripting language like Python or Ruby on Rails or whatever it may be, any query language, whatever it may be. So I'm writing some program here. Just say that 10 KB of program I have written for processing this 200 MB of data. Now let me know. Yesterday we have seen something that I have written some 1 MB of program. I wanted to process 1 TB of data. I have to send this program towards that data, or else I have to get that data back to my local machine where I'm writing that program. So which is better? And sending? Yes. So even though it seems somewhat, you know, less in size, even though it seems somewhat send in less time, but you should not send program towards your data. Data only should be brought back to your local machine where you are writing that program, where you wanted to run that one. So I told you, computation is always processor bound before Hadoop. Now let me know, which is better, sending this 10 KB of program towards that cluster is better, or getting that 200 MB of data back to your local machine is better? Sir, as you are saying that, if you wanted to get that 200 MB of data back to our local machine, why should we store that data, you know, into that cluster? You know, happily you can send this 10 KB of program towards your data which we are keeping in that, you know, which we have kept in that, you know, HDFS. Right? So then who is going to take care of that, applying this program on your data? In that time, job tracker will come into picture. Once I am writing some program, once I am submitting that, that job tracker will come into picture and it will take care of that request. It is taking and trapping that request and it is just trying to process that data on your HDFS. Okay, how it is going to take that request and how it is going to process that, we will see now. Now who is going to come in picture? Job tracker. Job tracker will come into picture. Now this program, you know, this job tracker will trap and take this request. What this client do is, I wanted to process this file.txt file and I wanted to get that output into what? Some, you know, test output directory. He is writing some query here. Basically he is writing, you know, some command. He wanted to process file.txt file. He is writing some program and he wanted to process this program on this file.txt file and he wanted to get that output into what? Test output directory. Now he is submitting that one. Now job tracker will take, trap and take that request. Now this job tracker, does this job tracker know what are all the data nodes which are having what blocks? Does this job tracker know what are all the blocks which we are having in different data nodes? No. He doesn't know that. Why? Because there is no such communication between job tracker and data node. As there is no such communication, this job tracker doesn't know what are all the data nodes which are having what blocks. So for that sense, what this job tracker will do? I told you, all these master services can talk to each other. So as this job tracker can talk to that name node, now this job tracker will send some request to that name node and it is saying that, you know, and this job tracker is just trying to send that request to this name node and it is saying that, hey name node, some client wanted to process file.txt file and he has given me some program. I wanted to apply that program on my, you know, file.txt file. I'm not aware of that, what are all the blocks we are having and where those blocks get stored in different data nodes. Okay, if you can give me those details from your metadata, I'll start processing that data. Something like that, this job tracker will give some request to this name node. Now this name node will just check it up, whether that file that which is requested by this job tracker is there in that metadata or not. Yes, is it there or not? File.txt is there. So this metadata will be given back to this name node, sorry, job tracker. Name node will give that metadata back to this job tracker once it is receiving some request from this job tracker. Now this job tracker knows very well that what are all the blocks are there in that metadata and where those blocks get stored in your, you know, data nodes. So as this job tracker knows that, now it is keeping this 10 KB of program with this and it is just trying to share this data to what? All task trackers. let me discuss with this, just 10 minutes. Observe here. Now it is, what is this job tracker's role? This job tracker is there for assigning task to what? Your task tracker. To whom it can contact with? Task tracker, right or wrong? Already you have seen. So it can contact with that task tracker. Now this job tracker will see where that a.txt file is available in system number 1, 2 and 4. Even though that a.txt file is available in 3 systems, it will never submit that job to 3 systems at a time. It will choose one system only, that is also what, nearer to that job tracker, because that request can be sent in what, less time. If it wanted to send that same request to system number 4, it may be taking some time. Instead of doing that, it is just trying to choose that nearer system, which is okay, nearby that job tracker. So now this job tracker will assign this task to this task tracker. It is saying that, hey task tracker, please take this 10 KB of program, and as I have known that metadata is there with some a.txt file which is there in system number 1. So I know very well that a.txt file is there in your local data node. Take this computation and start working on that. Something like that, it is giving some request to this task tracker. Now this task tracker is just trying to take this program and it is applying that on a.txt file. So you know, applying that program on your local a.txt file data, is it a process or not? That process we are calling it as what? Map. That process we are calling it as what? Map. So it is actually map. So it's done. So it is just have applied that program on what? 164 MB block size only. But it should apply that remaining, that same program on what? Remaining 64 MB of block sizes also. Now with this job tracker will choose b.txt file, where that b.txt file is available in system number 3, 5 and what? 8. So it is just trying to choose that system number 3 task tracker. Now it is saying that, hey task tracker, please take this computation and you have b.txt file in your local machine, local data node, start working on that. So it is just trying to start work on that. So that also what we are calling it as map, as well as for c and d.txt files also it is giving same request. So where that c.txt file is available in system number 5. So this also what we are calling it as map. So as well as the same computation will be given for system number 7 also. So it is also working on this. This is actually what d.txt file. This is also what we are calling it as map. Generally what we are calling this file.txt input file. What we are calling these 4 subfiles? Input splits. Input splits. Take that terminology. Very, very important. Okay. This is actually what? Input file. These are all what? Input splits. Input splits. So how many number of input splits are there in your file? Sorry, in your cluster. Those many number of mappers will be running. Exactly it is. Very, very important question for interview as well as for your certification exam also. How many number of input splits are there? Those many number of mappers will be there. Those many number of mappers will be there. It is fixed. So who is going to arrange all those things? Job tracker will take care of that. Who has given that job tracker? You know, Hadoop has given that. So as Hadoop is a framework, that framework itself can take care of that. How many number of mappers it should run on what? Number of input splits. So how many number of input splits you are going to have? Those many number of mappers will be there. Clear? Fine. Sir, when it is working, suppose when it is working, this system suddenly gets dead. Now what will happen? If the system is going to be down, data node will be lost. If data node is going to be lost, data will be lost. If there is no data, how this task tracker can work on that? It cannot be. So that task will be what? Disturbed. So if that task is going to be disturbed, this task tracker will just let this job tracker know, okay, that it cannot do that job because of loss of data on its local data node. Now this job tracker will give that same task to some other task tracker where you are having same a.txt file in its local data node. Because it has been given with what? 3 replications, right? So even if one data is going to be lost, one data node is going to be lost, some other data node will be there, okay, which is having same replication. So this job tracker will reassign that same job to some other task tracker where you are having what? Same a.txt file in its local data node. So which is nearby that system number 2. So it is giving that job to system number 2 task tracker, and this task tracker will work on this local data node. So that what we are calling it as, again this is also what? Map. Sir, this is all fine. If it is going to be down, this job tracker will give that same task to some other task tracker. How that job tracker can know whether this task tracker is working or dead? Sometimes if the system is going to be down, sometimes task tracker also may be dead. If the task tracker is going to be dead, it cannot complete that job. That time this job tracker will give that same request to some other task tracker where you are having same a.txt file in its local data node. But sir, it is giving that same request to some other task tracker. But how this job tracker can know whether this task tracker is working or not? You know, for that also, all these task trackers are slave services for this job tracker, right? So all these task trackers will give some heartbeat back to this job tracker for every 3 seconds to say that they are still alive and they are still working properly. If at any time, if any task tracker is not giving any proper heartbeat back to this job tracker will wait up to 10 heartbeats of time, means what, 30 seconds of time. In that time also, if this job tracker, if this task tracker is not giving any more heartbeat, that time this job tracker can think that either it may be working very slowly, either it may be dead. Sometimes there will be a situation that it can work very slowly. When it is, sir, as the system is nearby this job tracker, sometimes this system may be, you know, submitted with what, 100 requests also. Just say that 100 clients related input splits are there in this data node, because this data node's capacity is what, as it is 500 GB of, you know, hard disk, it can store 7500 blocks, right or wrong? So out of those many number of blocks, 100 clients have given 100 requests. So this task tracker is running 100 mappers. Task tracker is running what, 100 mappers. As it is running 100 mappers, sometimes as you are giving a.txt file, as you wanted to process that a.txt file in its local data node, that becomes what, 101 job. Just say that. Getting what I'm telling you? That becomes what, 101 job. Just say that. As it is 101 job, still it should complete 100 jobs. Now you have given 101 job also. So as you have given these many number of requests, this task tracker sometimes cannot give output in what? Sorry, so cannot give proper heartbeat in time to this job tracker as it is slowly working. As it is slowly working, sometimes this task tracker cannot give proper heartbeat back to this job tracker. That time, this job tracker can think that either it may be working very slowly, either it may be dead. If it is thinking that either it may be working very slowly or it may be dead, it is giving that same, you know, request to some other task tracker where you are having same input speed in its local data node. Clear? Sir, when, so sometimes this job tracker can monitor everything here. It knows very well that how many jobs it is running. Sometimes if it is running 100 jobs, even though it is nearer to this job tracker, sometimes it may be giving that same task to some other task tracker where it is, you know, where that system is somewhat far away from that job tracker. Why it is, sir? If you are going to give the task to this task tracker, already it is running 100 jobs, now it is what, 101 job. To complete those 101 jobs, it is taking 1 hour of time. Just say that. But if you wanted to send the same job to some other task tracker, even though it is somewhat far away from that job tracker, that request will be sent in what, 5 minutes, and that process will be done in what, 15 minutes, but your whole job will be done in what, 20 minutes, but here it is taking what, 1 hour. Right or wrong? Sometimes even though it is near to that job tracker also, it will never give that request to that nearest system task tracker. It can give that same request to some other task tracker also where it is, you know, somewhat far away from that job tracker. Sir, small example. See, just say that Vengadadri Express is waiting under platform number 1. On platform number 1. So it will be started in 5 minutes. Okay, I have reached that station now. I wanted to get the ticket. But at ticket counter, there are 100 people. So I'll be what? 101 fellow in that. If I wanted to get the ticket, how much time it is taking? Half an hour of time it is taking. Just say that. But train will be started in 5 minutes. Some other counter is there where there are no people. But it is somewhat far away from that. But I can reach that, you know, ticket counter in 2 minutes. I can get that ticket in 1 minute. I can reach that train in 1 minute. So 4 minutes will be done. So do I need to wait for, you know, that ticket in this ticket counter? Even though it is nearby that, I need not to wait for that much of time, because the train will be left, right or wrong? So I can go there, I can get the ticket, and I can done that, you know, I can do that work in less time. So in that same situation, sometimes even though this task tracker is somewhat nearer to this, it will never give that request to this task tracker. It is just trying to choose what? Somewhat far away task tracker. Okay, which is, okay, lying far away from this job tracker. Clear? So now you got that, you know, all these things, that heartbeat. This task tracker will give heartbeat for every 3 seconds. All these task trackers will give that one. Okay, and apart from that, I mean, along with that, you know, heartbeat, all these task trackers will even give what? Number of slots. Some task tracker may be saying that, along with that heartbeat, hey job tracker, some slots are available in my local task tracker. If you wanted to process either of these data sets, you can happily assign that task for me. Something that it is also giving what? Some blog report, I mean, some request for this job tracker. Every task tracker will give that type of, you know, request also. So as they are giving this task, this job tracker will choose those task trackers to assign some job for those slots. Enough. If one task tracker is going to be done, then it is giving that same task to some other task tracker where you are having same a.txt file in its local data node or some other block. What will happen if this entire job tracker is going to be done? Again, you are going to lost. You know, nothing will be lost. Data will not be lost because name node is there, data node is there. What will be lost? You know, job tracker. If job tracker is going to be lost, all your tasks will be disturbed. All your tasks will be what? Disturbed. So it becomes somewhat problem here again. So for that reason, what we are doing, we are maintaining high reliable hardware even for this job tracker also, to not to get any more failover on that. So here also this job tracker can be called as what? You know, single point of failover. So name node and job tracker both are what? Single point of failovers only. Clear? Fine. Sir, this mapper is running on this a.txt file. So how much output will be given from this a.txt file? For 64 MB of block size only it is giving output, right? Just say that it is giving some output as what? 4 KB of output. Right? From b.txt file also it is giving some output as what? 4 KB. From c.txt file it is giving 3 KB of output. From d.txt file it is giving 1 KB of output. Because its size is what? 8 MB only, right? So it is giving somewhat less output. When can we... This is what the total output for this 200 MB of file. When can we say that this is what the total output of this 200 MB of file? No. Observe here. I'll give you one small example. Okay. I wanted to, you know, count Simandhra population. I wanted to count Simandhra population. So how many districts are there? 13. 13 districts are there. So I'm taking 13 people and I'm assigning each district with what? One guy. So I'm starting from what? Srikakulam, Vijayanagaram, Vishakhapatnam and so on up to what? Anantapuram. Anantapuram. Okay. Via Ongole. Okay. Via Nellur. Okay. Fine. So I'm taking 13 people for 13 districts. Now this guy will get some count from what? Srikakulam. Right? Just say that this guy is getting some count as what? 10. This guy is getting from, you know, Vijayanagaram, he is getting 20, he is getting 30, and so on up to what? Anantapuram is getting some 100, because this is the one biggest district in what? AP. Just say that. Now, when can we say that this is what the total population of this Simandhra? Right, by adding, you know, by combining all your outputs. So, who is going to combine that? Somebody will be there, that guy will take care of what? Combining all your, you know, outputs from your districts. Right or wrong? Observe here, counting people is a process or not? That process, what I'm calling it as map. So how many mappers will be there? 13 mappers will be there. How many districts are there? Those many number of mappers will be there. Who should take care of combining all your mappers output? Red user will come into picture. That red user will take care of what? Combining all your outputs, and it is finally giving what? Output. So here also, four mappers are there. Four mappers are giving four output files. So who should combine all your outputs? When can we say that this is what the total output of, you know, your 200 MB file? When somebody is going to combine all your outputs, and when that guy is going to give total output, that output will be what? 200 MB of, sorry, that output will be actual output for this 200 MB file. So who should take care of that? Red user should take care of that, right? So by default, one red user will be there here. As per the number of, you know, input splits, you will be having number of mappers. But how many number of red users you are going to have, those many number of output files will be there. How many number of input splits are there, those many number of mappers will be there. How many number of red users are there, those many number of output files will be there. So by default, one red user will be there for this cluster. So we cannot say that where that red user is going to be residing in. Just say that that red user is there in your system number 8. System number 8. Now this red user is just trying to combine all your, you know, outputs of what? Mapper. This red user will combine that, and this red user will finally process that, and it will give output finally. So where that output will be given? That output will be given in this local data node itself, or it can be given in what? Some other data node also. Clear? Suppose if that output has been given in this local data node itself, so when this data node is giving block report on heartbeat to this name node, that time it is saying that some client has processed this data and I have given some output with some output direct as what? Test output. It is there in system number 8. System number 8. because of giving that blog report back to that name node will take care of creating metadata for that test output. Now everything is done here. Client can always watch how much, you know, up to till what extent that job has been done. If it is going to be done for 100%, now this client is directly contacting this name node, and he will see that metadata, and he is just trying to see whether that test output which has been given by that client is there in your metadata or not. If it is there, where that test output is available in system number 8, so that this client is directly approaching this system number 8, and he is going to get that output back to this client machine. Okay, so this is what map reduce is. So if you wanted to store data, what are all the services we need to have? If I wanted to store data, what are all the services I need to have? What are all the services I need to have? Name node, data node, that's it. Leave about that second name node, that we will see later. Name node and what? Data node. Name node will take care of, you know, creating metadata. Data node will store, you know, actual data. If I wanted to process data, what are all the services I need to have? Job tracker and task tracker. So job tracker is always, you know, assigning tasks to different task trackers, and task tracker is always receiving that request, and it is just trying to process on that data. Okay, so how many number of mappers will be there? Sorry, how many number of input splits are there? Those many number of mappers will be there. How many number of reducers are there? Those many number of output files will be there. So this is actually what the way of storing and processing your data. This is map reduce is, and this is HDFS is.